So imagine you've been rich your whole life. You got a personal chef, a support staff, and you've never had to actually cook or clean or lift a finger at all. You have absolutely no clue how to use a stove or a microwave or anything else as a result. Life runs pretty much an autopilot for you in this instance. Then one day, something breaks, whatever it is, supply chains collapse, disaster strikes, and that help doesn't show up. And suddenly you're left in a million-dollar kitchen, basically starving and completely dependent on systems that you never actually understood. And that's because you never took the time to learn how to cook. I know people personally who are the same way, but, you know, with that, with like ordering out, they order out every meal due to this inability to be able to cook or not wanting to cook, basically. And it ends up creating a reliance. It's not so good. I bring this up because that's kind of the modern digital world that we live in. People are raised to be users. They're pushed like drug addicts to the newest, shiniest thing. Psychologists analyze how to make apps, social media, and more stuff like that as addictive as possible. And as a side effect, we have more brain rot and lack of attention spans. And in addition to that, our collective lives, as it were, are basically managed by distant corporations. Much of the time, our files live on someone else's servers, and we pay for the pleasure in the TOS or the terms of service, which nobody actually reads and are often the stuff of nightmares when you actually do decide to go through them. With even some companies saying that they can use stuff like your child's photos to sell to advertisers, or can sell your data to brokers. Essentially, none of it is actually good. Our messages pass through surveillance pipelines that we're either told don't exist or they're to protect us, depending on the day of the week. And our memories, things like family photos, childhood videos, or more personal moments, are scanned and cataloged and fed into systems that none of us are actually allowed to see the inner workings of or even know about in general. In some cases. Nowadays, they're used to train AI, for which we'll get no actual objective benefits. We're all used to these convenience platforms like Google Photos that give us memories on demand. But that convenience obviously comes at a cost of total surveillance and dependency. You don't own your data in this case. You license access to it until they decide you don't. And even with the so-called privacy-focused platforms, you never really know your stuff safe unless you encrypt all your stuff manually prior to upload. Remember, there's a massive difference between trusting and verifying. So this tutorial that we're about to go through isn't, you know, about the dark net markets like I usually do for my regular watchers or some dumb thing that Tor did. Instead, it's about taking back just a little bit of your data. And don't freak out. It's very straightforward. It's not going to be hard to do. Today, we're going to try to reclaim some of the control over our photos and our videos by self-hosting our own private gallery. And it'll have facial recognition that actually works entirely on the hardware, smart search for photos using metadata. It'll have stuff like automatic timeline organization, full resolution storage with absolutely no compression, and cross-device syncing, location mapping, shared albums, and customizable control access control. Its name, Immich. It's also available as a mobile app for both iOS and Android if you want to pick it up. So you can automatically back up photos from your phone, just like with Google. Now, before we get started, I'm going to be using Linux Mint, just because that's what I like for little projects like this. It's free. Anyone can use it. It's very easy to set up. That's not what this is about, but also Docker and Docker Compose is going to be needed to run in order to be able to install it. And an external drive with sufficient space for your photos if the hard drive doesn't have enough space. I'm doing this because this is just how I want to set it up. It's actually easier to set up if you don't want to do that, if you want to have everything in one spot. It's really up to you at the end of the day where you want it to be stored. So let's begin with the basic commands. And again, you don't actually have to really do anything. You're just almost copy and pasting and just changing some stuff around so it specifically works on your system. The first command makes a directory on our external drive where all the photos and videos will actually be stored. You can see here where it says external too. You're going to want to replace that with wherever you're going to have your stuff stored. The second command creates a folder for the database in your home directory. If you want to store it somewhere else, just change that path. The next command creates our configuration file, and this is where we actually tell Immich exactly where to put everything. And you'll need to edit three things here. First, make sure the upload location matches your external drive if you want to do that, or wherever you want them to be stored. And third, you could change the password from testing 123 if you want something more secure. I highly suggest that you set like a 50-character password that's alphanumeric, but don't touch the TypeSense key. That part automatically creates a random security key, and without it, Immich will crash on startup. Now, we download the actual official configuration file, and this tells Docker how to actually set up the containers Immich needs to run. Notice that we're getting a specific version here. This version is 1.82.1, which is stable and tested. If you're watching this in the future, you're going to want to check GitHub to see what the actual current version is, and just replace that number when you actually do this. Finally, the last command starts everything up, and that was it. It was very straightforward. Now, to be specific, the D flag, or switch D, tells Docker to run everything in the background so you can close your terminal without actually stopping it. Once it's running, you actually access it by going to localhost and then the port in your browser, and it'll pop up. If you want to use it from your phone or another computer, you'll basically need the computer that you're running it on's IP address. If you run into issues, some of the basic ones that you might see, a couple troubleshooting tips just in case you actually run into it. If the container keeps restarting, check the logs with Docker logs, Immich server. If you see database connection errors, make sure db underscore hostname is set to Immich Postgres. If you see TypeSense errors, verify your ENV file contains a valid TypeSense API key. Remember that this tutorial is just to get your foot in the door and get you up and running with the very basics. For a complete setup, you should also consider regular database backups, which can be set up with a simple cron job, secure remote access if you want to reach your actual photos from the outside of your home network, which is a whole video in itself, enabling facial recognition in the admin settings if that's important to you. Unlike cloud services, Immich's facial recognition happens entirely on your hardware. The faces, identities, and analysis never actually leave your network, so your privacy actually remains intact. And that's it. That's all it takes. A few commands and some changing of some words, and you've got complete control over your photos, which means no more giving your information to these tech giants, you know, to access your private memories or, you know, valuable information. Like, no more wondering who's actually analyzing your family vacation pictures or scanning your child's birthday photos. You stay out of data breaches. Your memories stay yours on hardware that you actually control and managed by software that you can actually inspect, all without the corporate surveillance or forced upgrades, which allows them to change the rules whenever they get enough dependent lemmings actually using it. This small act of digital sovereignty might seem trivial and kind of stupid, but it is a good first step towards building a more resilient and private digital life. It's also the first video in this self-hosting series. The journey of 1,000 miles always starts with a step. Nowadays, everything is connected to someone else's computer, and you basically owning your own data is obviously privacy. However, it's even more important to note that it's also freedom. Thank you for watching to the end, and as always, I'll see you in the next video.